typically the most difficult thing is to you save your bones from a chicken. And also if you can get some of the chicken feet and heads and things. I know that's very foreign to a lot of people. But even if you just save the bones and cook those up, you have a nice bone broth. I was just visiting with a woman from Italy, and she said, oh, of course, we just grew up that way. We never threw the bones away. Or you would make a stew with the pieces that had the bones and the tendons and the cartilage and so forth. And that collagen is so good for you. It's so good for your own collagen, but it's also very good for detoxification. People don't realize that the components in broth help you detoxify, and also for your mood. And this is one of the amazing things about broth. It helps regulate your dopamine levels. And so you don't have to regulate your dopamine levels by eating chocolate or drinking a cup of coffee. You're getting that nice, good, happy feeling from the soup that you eat every day.
From the Weston A. Price Foundation, welcome to the Wise Traditions Podcast for wise traditions in food, farming, and the healing arts. We are your source for scientific knowledge and traditional wisdom to help you achieve optimal health.
Hey, Hilda here. After enjoying fried chicken or roast turkey, we often throw away the bones. But did you know that all traditional cultures made use of animal bones? Usually in the form of gelatin-rich bone broths. Today, a lot of us are missing out, no bones about it. This is episode 280, and our guest today is Sally Fallon Morell, the president of the Weston A. Price Foundation. Sally is a woman at the forefront of the slow food, alternative health movement. She is a researcher, author, and popular speaker. Today, she reviews principle number 10 of the 11 Wise Traditions principles, which covers the use of animal bones in the diet. Sally explains the many ways we can benefit from including them in our own diet, especially as bone broth, which is great for detoxing, boosting mood, strengthening bones, along with improving cognitive function and decreasing our addiction to coffee, sugar, and even chocolate. She also reveals the various ways in which some traditional people groups included bones in their diet, explaining customs of the Inuits and the Native Americans, for example. Before we dive into the conversation, we want to remind you that we have online groups for parents. If you are looking for support on how to nourish your children and yourself, join the Nourish Children 2.0 and Nourish 2.0 groups on Facebook for one donation of only $5 for the calendar year. Nourishing Our Children is a project of the Weston A. Price Foundation. And Ancestral Supplements Grass-Fed Beef Liver. Grass-fed and grass-finished liver from pasture-raised cows is among the most nutritionally dense food in existence. This type of high-quality liver is loaded with vitamins, minerals, proteins, and healthy fats that support collagen synthesis, immune health, and heart, brain, and liver health. Our early ancestors knew this, which is why their traditional diets included the frequent and nourishing consumption of this nutritional powerhouse. Ancestral Supplements grass-fed beef liver is 100% pure bovine liver. Visit AncestralSupplements.com and order yours today. Ancestral Supplements, putting back in what the modern world left out. By the way, this episode is from our archives and originally aired in March 2018. Enjoy! This is Holistic Hilda, and you're listening to Wise Traditions. Welcome to Wise Traditions, Sally.
Thank you, Hilda. I'm glad to be back.
So we are going through our series based on the principles of healthy diets. And we are on number 10. Can you tell us what that's about?
This is a surprising one. All traditional cultures made use of bones in some way. They consumed bones in some way. And this is where I think a lot of the diet plans today are missing out. Because in traditional cultures, even if they had dairy products, they also took the bones of small animals and they ground them up and made a paste and added these bones to their diet. Or they ate fermented bones. Yes, they ate softened fermented bones. Or they made bone broth. And all of these methods, but especially the ground up bones, would give you calcium in the diet. And you really do need that extra calcium. You cannot get adequate calcium from vegetables and meat. You need, first of all, the dairy products, but you also need these bones.
This sounds so foreign to us in the Western culture, doesn't it?
Yes, it does. If you look at some of the diet plans out there and they say you're going to get your calcium from broccoli, okay, or kale or whatever, you would have to eat about 8 cups of broccoli every day, and it can't be done. It's obvious it can't be done. Even if you could choke down 8 cups of broccoli every day, it just can't be done. And the traditional cultures understood this. They knew they had to eat bones to have strong bones. And they didn't know what calcium was or anything like that, but they knew they had to eat bones. Pretty much on every continent, I've found descriptions of grinding up the little birds and the little mammals and putting the bones in their food.
So this is not just what Dr. Price found, but it's also something the foundation has come to realize through much study.
Yes, through reading of different observers and so forth. Now, the Eskimos, they fermented the fish and the bones became really soft. And so when they ate the fish, they were eating the bones, and that's how they got their calcium.
The only time I eat bones, I think, is like in sardines or some fish.
That's right. We really don't eat bones. But we have dairy products in our diet, and so we don't necessarily have to eat bones. But people who are allergic to dairy, who can't do dairy, won't do dairy, whatever, this is very important to get these bones. And we tell people to make a chicken broth and cook it till the bones get really soft. And you can just crush up those bones and add them to your soups to get your calcium.
The principle says all traditional cultures make use of animal bones. And so it is a variety of ways in which they access the nutrients from the bones, as you're saying.
It's the main way that they would get calcium. I just finished a chapter on the African diet, and they definitely fermented bones and made a kind of fermented bone paste. It sounds ghastly, but this was a very important part of the diet. Especially in the tribes that didn't have cattle or didn't have goats. So there's a tendency today in modern dietary schemes to minimize the need for calcium, but Dr. Price found that these traditional cultures had at least 15 milligrams of calcium per day, and you can get that very easily with a couple of big glasses of raw milk or several ounces of cheese, but if they didn't have those types of foods, they had to get that calcium from bones.
So it's the bones are for our bones. Also, I'm thinking of this because I keep seeing not only older people with boots on their foot because they broke their ankle, but I see young people as well breaking bones all over the place. Is this one reason why you think they're deficient in calcium?
Well, that's one reason. Of course, we put a big emphasis on the fat-soluble vitamins, A, D, and K, and you need those fat-soluble vitamins to use the calcium properly to make healthy bones. So you also need phosphorus, which we get from lots of foods, including bones. So you need the fat-soluble vitamins, A, D, and K, and you need the calcium and phosphorus. But we definitely are seeing very fragile bones, even in babies. You know, this shaken baby syndrome where a baby will be taken in with bruising, and the parents haven't done anything. The bones in these babies are just so fragile because of vitamin D deficiency, calcium deficiency, who knows what. And then the parents are accused of shaking the baby and causing injuries in the baby. But it's malnutrition that's the problem here.
That is so heartbreaking.
Yeah.
Can you tell us more about the different people groups around the world that use bones and in what ways they do?
Okay, so we've got the Eskimos who are fermenting the fish. We have people in Africa who ferment the bones. They make fermented bone paste. We have several descriptions of American Indians grinding up bones of small animals, so there's another way. And then, of course, we have the almost universal practice of cooking the bones in water. And you're not just cooking the bones, you're cooking the joints, tendons, and cartilage and everything. And that's not only giving you calcium, but that's giving you all the components of the cartilage, the glycine, the special amino acids, collagen. Again, it's a universal practice. The Eskimos made stews and soups by cooking the bones of their animals. It was a widespread practice in Africa. Asia, of course, they have bone broth with every meal. The beef broth is a fixture of the Korean diet. And the American Indians, they cooked the bones and they would put hot rocks in the water and put the bones in to make a broth. It was a universal practice.
And I feel like people are coming around to this broth idea, partially probably because your book, Nourishing Broth, but just an understanding that we do need what the nutrients are that come from these bones.
In fact, the earliest recipes that we have are from Samaria. They found these tablets with something like 25 recipes, and they're all recipes for broth, for broth made with bones, and then they put blood in or organ meats or meat, but they were all recipes for broth.
Not for cheesecake.
No, they were not for cheesecake. Most of them were for broth. And then there were three other on another tablet that they found that were like a meat pie, like a chicken pot pie. Chicken with a broth, a gravy, in a kind of bread casing.
That is fascinating. That
amazing, yeah.
Now, this might be hard for some folks to hear who try to avoid animal foods altogether, right?
Yes, one of the nutrients that's really hard to get from plant foods is calcium. First of all, it's just not a lot of calcium in plant foods, not in the concentration that we get in the animal foods. And also, it's often blocked by things like oxalic acid, which make it very hard to absorb the calcium in the plant foods. So yes, you would expect to see a lot of bone problems, growth problems in people on a plant-based diet. If you do have a plant-based diet and you can just get a little animal food in, and especially the broth, it's very sparing, it's protein sparing. So if you just add that small amount of animal food to a plant-based diet, you're going to do a lot better.
Interesting. So you don't need a lot.
You don't necessarily need a lot of animal foods. They need to be very high quality if the amount is very limited. And I can't think of a better example of than Africa, where most people are really very poor. They can't afford a lot of meat. It is a plant-based diet. And yet, as long as they're not starving to death, they do well on the diet. And that's because the animal foods that they are eating give them these fat-soluble nutrients. They eat things like insects, frogs. And when they do kill an animal, they eat the whole animal, including the organ meats, and then they cook up those bones.
That's less wasteful and more sustainable when you use the whole animal than the way we tend to process animals here in the United States, it feels like, most of the time.
One of the worst things is that butchers are not allowed to put organ meats in sausage and hot dogs and things. And that's where the organ meat should be going. That's the way they do in many cultures. They hide them in the sausage and the scraffle. So all of these organ meats are hidden, and they're not allowed to do that here in the United States. So that source of organ meats, which any child would eat, is gone for us.
Coming up, Sally goes into how broth regulates dopamine levels. And she also explains why it is exactly that we have to work so hard to rediscover lost wise traditions like making bone broth.
You're listening to the Wise Traditions Podcast from the Weston A. Price Foundation. We pause now to recognize our sponsors.
Ancestral Supplements. Ancestral Supplements grass-fed beef liver, in particular. For most of human history, we effortlessly consumed the things we needed for strength, health, and happiness. Like the fertile ground we once walked upon, we were a natural extension of this earth. In the modern world, we struggle to fulfill our nutritional needs and sustain a vibrant, disease-free life. Grass-fed and grass-finished liver from pasture-raised cows is among the most nutritionally dense food in existence. Our early ancestors knew this, which is why their traditional diets included the frequent and nourishing consumption of this nutritional powerhouse. High-quality liver is loaded with vitamins, minerals, proteins, and healthy fats that support collagen synthesis, immune health, and heart, brain, and liver health. Whole food, nutrient-dense organs can provide great benefit for those seeking targeted support in harmony with nature, the way that our early ancestors did. Ancestral Supplements grass-fed beef liver is a whole food dietary supplement that provides 100% pure bovine liver. Visit Ancestral Supplements and order yours today. Ancestral Supplements, putting back in what the modern world left out. And Mountain Rose Herbs. Mountain Rose Herbs offers high-quality, organically grown herbs, spices, teas, and botanical goods. They are big on the things that we all care about: quality. Their products are certified organic, vibrant, tasty, and proven safe. Responsible sourcing from organic farmers and wild harvesters is their hallmark. And they offer a variety of products, including essential oils, candles, soaps, and more. Plus, they've earned a zero-waste certification in Oregon. Go to Mountain Rose Herbs at mountainroseherbs.com and place an order today. That's mountainroseherbs.com. This is Holistic Hilda, and you're listening to Wise Traditions. Growing up in the U.S. and in the area in which I did, it's a little bit foreign to me about how to make broth. Can you give us some how-tos?
Well, typically, the most difficult thing is to you save your bones from a chicken. And also, if you can get some of the chicken feet and heads and things. I know that's very foreign to a lot of people. But even if you just save the bones and cook those up, you have a nice bone broth. I was just visiting with a woman from Italy, and she said, oh, of course, we just grew up that way. We never threw the bones away. Or you would make a stew with the pieces that had the bones and the tendons and the cartilage and so forth. And that collagen is so good for you. It's so good for your own collagen, but it's also very good for detoxification. People don't realize that the components in broth help you detoxify, and also for your mood. And this is one of the amazing things about broth. It helps regulate your dopamine levels. And so you don't have to regulate your dopamine levels by eating chocolate or drinking a cup of coffee. You're getting that nice, good, happy feeling from the soup that you eat every day.
That sounds so nourishing and wonderful. And nobody wants to be addicted to coffee or to chocolate.
And the reason we are, I think, is because these fundamental components of the diet are missing. And we don't feel well. We don't feel naturally happy. So a piece of chocolate makes us feel happy, or sugar makes us feel happy. But if we're really eating a traditional diet with all the good glycine and the bone broth and everything, we should not feel tempted by these other ways of raising our dopamine.
And the thing is, I think on our Weston A. Price Foundation YouTube channel, we have videos on how to make broth that Sarah Pope made some years ago. Is that right?
Yes, we do. We have quite a few videos. We have recipes, all sorts of ways to learn how to make broth. It's just not hard.
It's just that it's, again, a little bit foreign when we haven't grown up with that. And we're trying to rediscover those wise traditions. That's why we have this show.
That's exactly right. And most of us did not grow up with these traditions. When immigrants came to this country, they were actually encouraged to forget their food traditions. It was patriotic to buy these cheap American foods. Americans were told that it's patriotic to buy cheap food. It was like deliberately suppressed. And now we have to come back through it with an understanding of why and sort of forge new ground like pioneers, because we're learning to do these things all over again.
I'm thinking back to my own childhood. My mom's from Mexico, and she and my nanny would sometimes make this caldo, this broth-based soup that was pungent because they would put cabbage in it and stuff like that. As a little American kid, I would turn my nose up at it, but now I realize it was one of those wise traditions.
Yes, and my mother was from the South, and she made chicken broth. We just accepted that. She used it in gravy and soup, and she told us it was good for us, and she told us it would give us beautiful skin. So there was a health tradition associated with the chicken broth, and that was something that we continued in our family, to make the broth.
Isn't there a South American proverb that says, a good broth can resurrect the dead?
Yes, or one is fish broth will cure anything.
And that's why people say, too, chicken soup is good for the soul, or you give it to someone who's sick because there's something really nourishing about it.
Yes, it's helping you detoxify, it's helping you get over your cold, and makes you feel good.
Have you heard of oxtail soup, Sally?
Oh, yes. In fact, oxtail soup was a real staple in my family when my kids were growing up. Because I could get a package of oxtails and make a soup that would last for 2 days for the whole family. And everyone loved it. Put barley in it, cut up all the meat, and cook the bones till they were just falling apart. And that would make a beautiful, delicious, hearty soup. Oxtail soup was like a big deal in our family.
And I feel like this is a good conversation for people who say, I can't afford to eat organic. I can't afford to eat this way. Because this is not expensive.
No, and I had a real tight budget when I was raising my family, 4 really hungry children. And the way you do it is with soup. You save those bones, you make the oxtail soup. We had lentil soup twice a week for years because it was just inexpensive. And I could put all the leftovers in there, and I had the broth, and the kids were happy with it.
That sounds wonderful. And I hope that's encouraging to folks who are listening or thinking, what the heck? How do I eat this way? I have a friend that was at a butcher shop recently, and she got kind of things that were just going to go into some kind of recycling bin from the butcher for a song, and was able to, again, extend her family's food budget.
Yes, the soups and the stews are the way to do it, because you can put anything in there. They stretch a long way. They're very filling and satisfying.
So talk to us again about the benefits of what we're getting from those bones. How do they really help our brain and bodies function?
Okay, so first of all, we're getting calcium, and especially in the traditional cultures from the eating those bones, so ground up bones. And then when we make the bone broth, we're getting all the benefits of collagen and the detoxifying benefits of the glycine and the dopamine regulating benefits. So there's a whole list of benefits we get from the bone broth.
Including brain function that's improved.
Yes, we need a lot of those nutrients for our brain. The glutamine, for sure, we need for our brain. It's not the ultimate brain food. The ultimate brain food, it would be animal fats, because your brain is made of cholesterol and fat. But the bones are really for your bones.
I think you've told me, and I've read in Dr. Price's book, that when he traveled the world, he expected he would find some cultures that ate solely plant-based diets. Yes. And yet he didn't, to his surprise.
Yes. This was said to be his greatest disappointment. He had hoped to find a culture that was healthy, eating only plant foods. And he did not find that. And he found that they went to a great deal of risk and trouble to get the animal foods. Even when they were at war with each other, there was a tribe in the interior that came down and got the shellfish. And the people they were at war with left little piles of shellfish for them because they knew that they would starve if they didn't have the shellfish. Wow. So even when they were at war with people, they still exchanged the animal foods.
I wish we were that decent with one another today.
Right, right. And all the sacred foods were animal foods. So all the foods that were considered very important for having healthy babies were the animal foods. I would definitely include broth and sources of calcium like raw milk, raw cheese, as sacred foods, very important for pregnant women.
Well, I want to say that's actually our next principle that we're going to talk about next time, right? Is what were those foods? It's good to know that they were primarily based on these animal products.
Yes, and it's very interesting. Science completely validates what these people did to prepare for pregnancy. So we can talk about that.
Absolutely. Now, the broth that you buy in boxes or cans at the store, is that the same product?
I really don't think so. It doesn't gel in the refrigerator. I'm very concerned about what happens in the flash pasteurization process. It's in aluminum-lined containers, and during that flash pasteurization, the aluminum can move into the broth. So I really think it's best to make your own. And then there are brands of frozen broth that you can get. And our shopping guide has many listed. It's going to be more expensive, but you can definitely have it sent to you.
I've heard some people call the really gelatinous broth gold.
Yes.
Because that's how you can tell it's good, because it is kind of jiggly.
Yes, it's jiggly, even at room temperature. It's still jiggly on the counter.
So I often end the interview with a question that I ask all the guests. So maybe pertaining to the use of the bones in our diet, what would you recommend that the listener do if they wanted to improve their health, Sally?
I would recommend that all listeners learn to make bone broth, learn to make chicken broth. It will not only improve your health, but it's the first step to becoming a great cook. Because when you have your chicken broth there, you have the basis for a wonderful soup. You have the basis for a reduction sauce. All the great recipes in cooking involve broth.
Thank you so much for your time, Sally. Our guest today was Sally Fallon Morell. Check out her blog at nourishingtraditions.com. And I'm Hilda Labrada-Gore. I have a blog on my website too, holistichilda.com. And for the transcript for this episode, visit our website, westonaprice.org, and click on the podcast page. And now for a letter from a recent journal. I'm in Switzerland, and in my small amount of spare time, I check out many secondhand shops looking for cookbooks, showing the history of food from countries like Italy, Spain, Greece, France, Germany, and Russia. I even have one called Das Römische Kochbuch des Apicius, from the time of the Romans, with half the book written in Latin. I also have two or three military cookbooks from Switzerland. In Europe, during and after the Second World War, there was famine everywhere, because streets were bombed, roads broken, businesses disrupted, stores empty, and most folks were on food stamps in order to distribute food equally. But these people were not vegetarians. Arnold Schwarzenegger, who just made a movie promoting vegetarianism, grew up on a farm in Austria and had raw milk. Has he forgotten? Every one of my newly obtained books include fatty meats of all kinds, with more fat than you ever see in any American supermarket. I have pictures from our past visits in Ukraine of an open farmer's market having huge tables filled with a slab of fat and more fat, organ meats and more organ meats, and all this in 90-plus degrees summer heat, sitting there all day. These people wanted meat, and that includes the Swiss military cookbooks. They even cooked with bone broth. Tomorrow morning, early, I'm out hunting for a special spoon or needle that butchers here use to thread fat strips into roasts. One can find roasts here wrapped in fatty bacon strips. Hello, Dr. Ansel Keys. That's from Judith in Switzerland. Judith, your letter made me smile. I love it, and it goes perfectly with this podcast about broth. And you are also welcome to write a letter to the editor that we might include it in an upcoming journal, or rate and review our show on Apple Podcasts. Thank you so much for listening. Stay well, my friend. Hasta pronto.
On behalf of the Weston A. Price Foundation, thanks for listening. We have many free resources to support you on your health journey. Visit westonaprice.org to find podcasts, articles, videos, and more. You can also find a local chapter near you for help in finding sources of great food. We invite you to support the Foundation's mission of education, research, and activism by becoming a member. Thanks again, and take care. Wise Traditions is a project of the Weston A. Price Foundation for Wise Traditions in Food, Farming, and the Healing Arts. The content on this podcast is provided for informational purposes only and is not intended to substitute for the advice provided by your doctor or other healthcare professional. It is not intended to be, nor does it constitute healthcare or medical advice.